In Space Watch, around 2:30 Eastern this morning, SpaceX launched its Falcon Heavy rocket for the third time. The complex mission is aiming to deploy 24 small science and technology testbed satellites into orbit for the Pentagon, NASA, and several other agencies. So CBS News space consultant Bill Harwood is in Merritt Island, Florida, joining us now to tell us how it all went. So listen, I heard Elon Musk describe this as probably the most challenging launch for the Falcon Heavy. Why would he call it that?
Well, you know, this is really interesting because this mission took 3 hours to conduct. In other words, from start to finish, to get all these 24 satellites launched, it took about a little more than 3 hours, but more complicated than that, they went into different orbits. You know, usually when a rocket takes off with a satellite, it puts it in a specific orbit, and that's the end of the story. But in this case, these satellites went into three different orbits, even with a different tilt to the equator, and so you had to fire the second stage engine of this rocket multiple times to get there, and then you had to, of course, deploy all of these satellites at the right time into the right orbits. And so, by definition, that's some pretty complex work.
Yeah, that sounds like it. I mean, your timing has to be perfect. How often does that happen where sort of multiple satellites need to be launched in different locations?
Well, it's really the different orbits that makes this one unique. Now, there have been a few launches where they launch a lot of CubeSats. These are really, really small satellites where they launch, you know, several dozen at one time. This was certainly a record for SpaceX, and these were not all CubeSats. Some of these were fairly significant payloads. So I can't say things like this happen all that often, but they do happen. Again, the thing that made this one unique is putting these satellites into these very different orbits.
And so then how did it go? Was it a success?
It went off perfectly. I mean, they got all 24 of those satellites exactly where they wanted them to be. I could barely keep my eyes open by the time number 24 went off, just a little bit after 6 a.m. Eastern time. But the satellites are all right there. Now, the only thing they didn't accomplish to make this a perfect sweep was they didn't get all three of their first stage boosters back. You know, SpaceX likes to recover those boosters so they can be refurbished and then launched again. It's part of their long-range goal of keeping costs down. Two of the boosters successfully landed back at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. And I got to tell you, it's the first time they've ever launched a Falcon Heavy at night. And watching those two guys come down under rocket power in the darkness was really something to see. But the center booster, they were trying to recover on an offshore drone ship several hundred miles out to sea. And that one got close, but just didn't make it. So two of the three rockets they got back, and that's a pretty good record. Nobody else can get any back. So yeah, they did pretty good. That's the only area where they came up short.
So you mentioned the satellites that were on board, also an atomic clock and an experimental propulsion technology. Yeah. What's all that stuff going to be doing up there?
Well, you mentioned the propulsion technology. You know, when we think about satellites in space, like communication satellites, et cetera, when they maneuver to get to very carefully stay in one place, they're usually using an extremely toxic rocket fuel. This stuff is very, very dangerous. You know, when people fuel up these satellites before launch, they have to be fully contained in what they call escape suits. You know, if you breathe this stuff or get it on your skin, it's potentially fatal. What they're looking at here is a system that uses a completely different propellant. And they're calling it green because it's not toxic. It's not something that's dangerous. You could actually fuel the satellite before you ship it to the launch site, perhaps even at a university or something like that. And at the same time, it's got a little bit more power than the rocket fuel they normally use. So that's a very big deal if it pans out. This is the first in-flight test of that technology. And if it works out, we may see a shift away from the very toxic hydrazine-type rocket fuels into this propellant. You mentioned the atomic clock. You know, whenever you're launching or sending a spacecraft into deep space, they have to have clocks on board. They communicate with Earth, and that's how they figure out exactly where they are in the solar system. But if you had a really accurate clock, the spacecraft could do it all by itself, and it would basically improve the navigation, make it much easier to conduct. You'd, in effect, have self-driving spacecraft, if you want to think about it that way. It would take out one of those steps from Earth that we currently have to make sure a spacecraft knows where it is. But you've got to have a really accurate clock, and that's what's on board. Very, very cool stuff.
Yeah, it sounds like it. I feel like whenever we talk, we're always, discussing things that are going up into space, but never what happens once, that stuff is no longer in use, otherwise known as space junk or debris.
Right.
What happens to that stuff? Does it sort of fly off out of the orbit? Does it come back down?
Well, it all comes back down eventually. Now, the reason space debris is dangerous is because everything in low Earth orbit is moving at roughly 5 miles per second. That's more than 17,000 miles per hour. So if you accidentally get hit by a washer, a nut, even a fleck of paint, for example, going that fast, it can damage a spacecraft or even trigger a catastrophe of some sort. So you don't want space junk. That's a bad thing. Now, over time, these things will eventually come down because even though we think of space as a vacuum, it really isn't in low Earth orbit. There's still a trace of atmosphere there. And as spacecraft plow through that, it slows them down very, very gently, slowly, I should say. And eventually, these things will fall out of orbit, but it takes a long time. And the higher it is, the longer it takes to come down. So space junk is a very, very serious problem that NASA and everybody else that goes in space is having to deal with. It's not trivial at all. And what you can do to clean it up, it's not yet clear how you're going to get rid of that. So everybody's trying their best to make sure they don't make any more space debris.
So at the risk now that you said this is actually a very serious thing, I'm going to make light of it. So apologies ahead of time. We have learned that space junkies can become space junk willingly. There's about 150 the cremated remains of space enthusiasts or space junkies, if you will, that also went up into orbit. What do we know about that? I mean, who gets that opportunity? How did that even come about?
Well, there's a company called Celestis that its business is to launch it. And we're not talking about an entire the amount of remains you would get from a cremated body, for example, a very small amount in canisters that are all packaged up very tightly in a very small satellite. They will launch some of these cremains into space for you at a charge, of course. And it's kind of a unique memorial, if you want to think about it that way. That's how they advertise it. And they've been doing this for many years. They can do it on suborbital rockets as well as orbital spacecraft, even spacecraft going to the moon or beyond. Now, in this case, the 152 cremains that were on board this mission, they're expected to stay up about 25 years. And then that will slowly come down, as we were discussing a moment ago, and it'll eventually re-enter the atmosphere and burn up. So it's really just a way for families and friends to kind of remember their loved ones, I guess. It's kind of a unique way to memorialize someone. It depends on your viewpoint. It's a neat thing or maybe not. I don't know.
I think it's neat. I think it's neat, especially for people who are passionate about space. Bill, thank you so much.
Sure thing.